become encountered in a long-standing relationship.
Yes.
I found the experience quite poignant.
No, I go back several years to share. You know, and my view as a Muslim professional is that Islam, for those of us who are fortunately both an Arabic speaker, and therefore you can read and understand the Quran and do dawah with it, and you can also iman the world and you can relate the world, and it's good parts and it's bad parts of what is taught in the Quran. I think we are the most well positioned to properly Islam. We are supposed to do that. You know, and I know Christian brothers, very, very rich Christian brothers. When I say they are entrepreneurs, they run their own companies. They employ over 200, 300 people. They turn over a couple of million or billion cedis as business people. On Saturday or Sunday, they take the Bible and go into communities, into households, to evangelize. Yes, they do that. They do that. They honestly do that. Then you know, they go to church and they know this person is dedicated himself as a worker of the church. Whether it's a pastor, it's a deacon, anybody who is dedicated is 24 hours is a worker of the church. When they are doing collection, they know that, in fact, there's a good part, but the majority of good part is that they, what the church gathers is what they will use to pay the pastor a decent salary. So the pastor will have a decent home, a means of transport. Most importantly, he's able to look after his family, take kids to school, and concentrate on studying the Bible. That's what these Muslim, this Christian brother of ours, who are in their corporate life, so you see a church is started in your local community, give them 2 years, 24 months, done, beautiful church. Come to, you know, throw it back to Muslims. We go to school, we come from these zones, we come from these very difficult communities. Once we get out, you don't even have to be Muslim to understand that you've gotten away from a very difficult situation. So whatever you can do, go back and improve that. So we just subtract ourselves. Islam, you know, you go to a chicken mosque and after the prayers they say sadaqa and then everybody's bringing coins in. You see our Islam, our imams, dedicated imams, they can't even be dedicated. They cannot be dedicated because they've got to go find a job to do. Even when pastors have another job to do, they still get a decent stipend from the church so that they can feel no pressure to be morally bankrupt. Yes, no, there's no pressure. So that's what I saw when I started work. Young family, and I was very,
passionate about Islam.
And I saw Sheikh dedicated himself to it.
Yes, sir.
So I could see it myself in his work. Wow. I could see myself in him.
Wow.
Yeah. So whatever I could do and still can do, I'm doing to support. See myself in the light of Sheikh Awa. Yes, I can see myself in the work of Sheikh Awa. I can see Sheikh Ibn Sana. You know, all of them. Sheikh Ibn Sana, Sheikh Aramia, what they call it, the former army.
Umar Sanda.
After Umar Sanda, the Imam Mutuku, or Imam Adam. You know, I like a guy called Imam Hussein.
Hussein.
I mean, police force. Apart from him, there is Imam Hussein, I think he comes from the central region.
Okay, there's another Hussein.
Yeah, it's Hussein. But yeah, he's very good with the English, Arabic, English, Arabic, and Greek. You know, I've met him and you are seeing these are people. Those are the kind of people that we should be supporting. But you know, we don't have evidence of our.
When I just came in, I saw someone speak that language to you.
Yeah.
You've moved from the corporate to the traditional.
Yes.
How have you been coping with the pressure? Of course, you aren't a politician with a bottomless you know, bag of cash,
no,
to be distributed. No.
Hey, look here, I'm not precariously indebted. To the extent that I can do it, and I know I'm doing genuine service, I'm happy. Yeah. So the bit of frustration would be the rate of progress you want to see is probably not translated very quickly. You know, also the sense of ownership, the sense of responsibility in such among our people. You quickly find out over the years, it's not just giving them money. You know, you give money, you expect people over time to complete school, take responsibility, just like, because sometimes you still give money to somebody else. But when I was at this person's stage, you know, starting a career, because I dedicated myself to looking after other kids who are still in primary school, secondary school, or even university. So it's about, you know, so transitioning from corporate life, much more organized, you're speaking to a constituency or dealing with a constituency that understands the purpose, they are organized around the purpose.
Yes.
So it's easy to lead them.
Yes.
But in our traditional life, you are the purpose, you are the driver of the purpose. You know what I'm saying? You are the purpose, you are the driver of the purpose. Everybody.
Because there is no purpose to begin with. And so you are the purpose.
You're the purpose. You know, so you're the purpose. You got to define the purpose. And my brother always told me when adults ask themselves 2 + 2, they know the answer is 4. So when you clearly state it, now there's a problem. So that's what I'm saying. You are the purpose. So you will go and say, look, it's good to take kids to school. The minute you say take kids to school, when I come back here, then I get all sorts of requests. My kid is going to BCE. They even forget it's free. Then when you tell him it's free, now he says, no, now I have to take him somewhere else and transport. You know what I'm saying? So they will have money to do everything else. And I'll probably pay for kids with education. That's the only thing that frustrates me.
I believe you have so much satisfaction serving your people.
Absolutely. That would can never be.
You seem happier as a chief than an MBA.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's just satisfying because you look, right now, really, everybody should imagine the depth of the difference you make with your time. So if I look at where we have reached, it's the delta we can make in corporate life. Yeah, there was a little delta, but you can apply that same effort to community somewhere and the delta. The development delta is much bigger. You know, so at all times, you should be looking to apply your effort, your time, your resources to where your delta is the greatest. Yeah, so I'm looking at a traditional
way. I'll keep this conversation pretty short, looking at the pressure on you here.
Okay.
But Nandandi, you mentioned a very important point,
yeah,
that even though banking halls are scary,
yeah,
people come from the north, maybe, excuse me, in tattered clothing,
yeah,
but you come out and you have them.
Absolutely.
So you're inferiors,
yeah,
your juniors here, but that these are my people.
Yeah. Yeah.
These are my blood.
Yes.
So how can other people learn this? I see there's a great lesson for even our political leaders.
Yeah, yeah. Look, I think you should, when you love a person, or you go beyond the physical, love is so, it's so empowering that you actually live beyond the physical. So my love for a person is your person, is the potential the person represents. Your clothes can be dropped anytime, can be changed anytime. But my love for you is not a clothes, but it's not at all. Nice, but it's just an individual potential the person represents, you know, what you can achieve in together. You know, so it's very empowering and it gives you a certain energy that so embracing the person, the cause doesn't give me the energy. It's a love for the person that gives me the energy. So and when you do that sometimes. So why is it that presidents go or sportsmen or heroes when people are stretching their hands to just tap them? It's not like it's just to say this person after all is human, I can't be like him. So you transfer energy, you transfer energy, you transfer hope. This person has just got 5 fingers like me. You know, but when you come looking like you have more than 5 fingers, 5 toes, or 2 ears. So for those of us that are next to home, to listen to for energy, to listen to impact for inspiration, or when you have the opportunity to call yourself.
Now, how many subjects do you have within your jurisdiction in Kishibu? Or you've not done the census then?
So let's put the traditional authority in perspective.
Yes.
So the Yana is the overlord of the one traditional area.
Yes.
And you are paramount under the overlord.
Okay.
So you participate as a paramount in the general administration of the traditional area, which is a total like one traditional area. And the one total traditional area will be the one itself and our impact on the wider Ghanaian community. So that's the role as a paramount. And when I go back to a specific, paramount to where I am, you are looked at as a father figure. A father figure, look, their religion, their economic activity, their social entertainment, their marriages, their outdoors, their funerals are all vested in you. So, you are the symbol of their highest authority.
Wow.
So you've got to be conscious of that and reflect it in the way you speak, the way you conduct yourself, and of course provide leadership. So I'm saying, you are really. So you have all these council of elders, most of them very old people.
Maybe you're a PhD and your council of elders or advisors maybe never stepped foot into a classroom.
That is why the true definition of a PhD comes from. That is where the true definition of a PhD comes from. It's when you sit with those old people, that is when you actually see the true definition of a PhD. What they hang around your neck and the scroll they give you at an altar in the greatest auditorium of the world, to mean nothing. Absolutely comes to mean nothing when you sit among those elders. Yes. And they begin to dissect social problems, social issues, and to show their power out. It's amazing. But one of the things that I had to learn very quickly as a genius was to keep quiet and listen.
So you get schooled by the day as you give instructions.
Yes. Yeah, somebody opens his mouth and you don't know where the issue is. Over there, something that looks like a simple black and white. No, by the time you've been quiet and listened to the counsel of all of them, what you would have simplistically seen as this black and white is much, much more complex. Much, much more complex. So what I quickly learned was that one of those credentials we have is important. It comes from nothing when you really have to deal with a mass of people, particularly people. They need the end of development. You got to listen. So I quickly realized that I didn't have to speak. Because the other thing they do is that they have a lot of respect for the chieftains. So if you are the first to speak, what you have said is almost law. They will keep quiet. Yeah, they will keep quiet. Even if they have much more brilliant suggestions to make, they didn't immediately say it. Because if he sees it publicly, then he's contravening you. And you should never contravene a chief. No, they don't.
So the institution is that strong.
Yes. So then, if you withdraw in your private courses, the students come in, and be there, so then go into an ordinary conversation. And if you have ears, and play between those ears, you will hear commentary that reflects you back to what you said and to see what you have improved.
And
listened. So as I said, I quickly understood that what credentials we have in the formal life, when you go to a traditional place, please just keep quiet and listen.
Now, what are the things you've had to shed off? You are very handsome. Now perhaps you can't eat in flashy restaurants any longer.
Yeah,
what are the things you feel nostalgic about that becoming chief prevents you from enjoying?
I just would enjoy when I see a friend to embrace and give you a warm hug and handshake and all of that. But when you are in state, when you are with your people and the elders, even when you come to greet, I can just say,
So the handshake I just enjoyed, you couldn't have enjoyed it appreciable.
Yes.
Someone would have stopped me.
Somebody would have stopped you. And even as I know you, I just sit there and say, just a gentle smile. And then they will not then welcome you and say, you're welcome to this palace, you know what I'm saying? And now, they will invite you to come and receive cola from me. Yes. You first of all will now then announce yourself and your mission, and they will not, even what you have said has to be relayed back to me. You don't necessarily direct. What you have said, an elder will get up.
It's an intermediary.
Yes, an elder will get up and relay to me. Then if I have to speak, I'll speak direct to you. If I was sitting in public, so I'll now relay my, listen to the elder, my comments to the elder, who will now relay it back to you. I invite you to come and take cola from me. So if we need to speak like this, we have to go into my private quarters.
Wow.
Yes, you have to go into my private quarters, which is my private room. Then we can sit and be friends and throw our hands around and talk. But once you're sitting in the street, you've got to, you know, you're necessary, you're the symbol of your state, you're the symbol of everything. You know, everything just comes to you. So that's how it is.
So there are a few little limitations in terms of the personal relations. What about other
things? No, it doesn't really deteriorate your free to go to restaurants and eat. You know what kills my pelvis is when they're watching national television and I'm dressed like this making a speech. They say, why is this man cheaping in our chip tasting? The rest of the biggest problem I have
now. It seems to look cheap.
Oh, yes. Yes, it seems to look cheap. No. What's happening to you? It's to demean our custom.
Wow.
It's not a big deposit. Yeah. When they see me on, every time I do a speech and they pick it up on TV, I would get no less than 4 or 5 calls. Why is it that you go to this function and you're not portraying our tradition and you don't have an elder with you and do things, you know? I like to travel. I travel to Accra. So for example, when I get to, if I'm even going abroad, and the development man sees me, just walking like this, he's like, no, you can't do this. And you know what? That feeling goes from very highly educated people to, yes, you know, once he's at the woman and he knows you're a chief, when he sees you, no matter his status of life, he expects you to say, but you are here. So, you can be somebody that you were just relating with ordinarily, you know, 6 months before, but just immediately you cross that and they say you're that.
Yes.
From the very highest, expect you to now reflect what represents your achievements.
Now you sit in state how many times a year, considering how you've had to shuttle between Accra and Bishop?
So I at the moment, because I'm in full-time work, ordinarily Mondays, so Mondays you go to sit in states, so that all the elders will come and you have counsel with them, what is going to happen for the rest of the week, and what are the big issues, what has to be attended to, and then you kind of discuss it, and people go off to do that. Then Friday again, you come and sit in the state, so that's almost like, again, recounting what has happened during the week. So every Mondays and Fridays, once I'm home, I have to sit in the state. Every Mondays and Fridays.
And when you're
all of the, when I'm, then also we have, Cardinal Festival, our fire festival, Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. So it have become part and parcel of our traditional
The Gombe people have been Muslims for more than
For more than 500 years. For more than 500 years. Our history has been documented by our Muslim, brothers who came to. So in any paramountcy at the Yana's palace. The Yana is what the one we call Ulana, then the chief imam, then the chief drummer, then the head of the muskets, the ones who, the fighters, the warriors.
Yes.
They are the leaders in the absence of the chief. They are the core leaders of our communities. So the chief is the elders have the head who is called the Ulana. So all the wise men. Chief's wise man, the leader, is called the Ulana. So he comes, when chief is on the he comes. Yes. The next is the chief imam,
yes.
Then the chief drummer,
yes.
Then the head of the warrior,
yes.
That's how it's.
Now, I'll ask two more questions,
yeah.
But I'll take you into an uncomfortable zone.
Okay.
The first one now is with the status of the young man.
Yeah.
You are an international person. The last time we met, you had come from London.
That's right.
Otunfor said it has been packaged,
yeah.
To an extent he can address the United Nations.
Yes.
Are there any cultural sensibilities,
yes.
That prevent the Yana from becoming a foreign figure?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. And we look as the Gumbes, we look with a lot of respect to what the Asantehene, not just this one, all the Asantehenes have been able to achieve. If you look at the evolution of the two kingdoms, in fact, they would be the first to admit our kingdom goes back several hundred years before the Asante.
Even before the Asante Kingdom?
Yes, long before the Asante Kingdom.
Wow.
Long before the Asante Kingdom. If I, and again, this is not about the relationship, but if you go to the understanding of African Kassir and you see all those small things where with amulets on it, that traces back to our relationship with Asante. So there is that kind of, you know, brotherly relationship. So yes, to your point, if you look at the Otunfor, it's just the way in terms of leadership that they have organized around it. And it goes back to also the selection of, say, Otunfor.
Right.
So selection of Otunfor, they inherit matrilineal,
yes.
And you can just be picked off from whatever you're doing in the Asante in overnight.
No.
In our case, we inherit patrilineal.
Okay.
We inherit patrilineal,
wow.
And typically to the male son. And sometimes you get complicated through the male senior son. And then also you don't just get to, you just don't get up as an educated and then become a young man. No, we have graduation. So our settlements were done according to the structure of the kingdom. So at the furthest ends of the kingdom, where you had young princes, strong, vibrant armies who could push the envelope of the empire. So that's where the princes started off. So you start off as a, when start your own settlement, and your father will make you the overlord there.
Okay.
And then you raise an army, you go pushing the envelope. Now,
the kingdom was just expanding.
As you grow older, you move in. Move in. So you can go like five steps as an out. No, and there are levels of seniority.
Okay.
So you move from a junior, paramountcy, medium, high, and then you get to the final.
So
and they are in the concentric circles.
Wow.
So you can have, let's say, on the periphery,
yes,
about eight of those paramountcies on the same level. In the inner circle, they probably will have about six at the same level. And then again, in the third inner circle, we have about five in the same level. Then in the middle, second inner, you have currently like three who are equals. Karaga, Pisho, Karaga, Sabrubu, Aluminium, and then one of them emerges as Yana. So that kind of structure, you know, which is very traditional, has for a very long time made sure that we have elected, as it were, Western educated chiefs. So I'm trying to just evolve how the Asante one is organized, probably looks so he can address the United Nations. So then somebody emerges as the young man that we have now. He is the most senior of the princes, he's the most senior of the chief, the paramount, that's why he is. But if you were to look at Western education, you know, he hasn't got that. Now he now then needs us, the educated people, sometimes who are not even chiefs, to organize properly to say, okay, how do we participate in the national development effort, in economic development, political development, legal services, you know, employment, you know, education. Okay, so you know, if you have an Asante who's educated, is able now to get all of our chances, whether they are in the line of chieftaincy or not, to help to organize Ashanti to participate. So if he's delivering a speech on Gabbies didn't write it. It's probably a former minister of finance who is an Ashanti who is writing it for him. So the content of it, it speaks to subject matter, if you're speaking on anything. So that's how, you know, it is. But it's not because, so if we were able, and also our the long strife that we as the Romans have had, we've had a long strife around, you know, really settling on the selection of the young. So from myself from 1973, so probably now, it's always been strife. So that hasn't allowed us also as intelligentsia to go back and say, okay, this chieftaincy, no matter how powerful you are, you can even become the head of state. It's very much like Ashanti. If, let's say, Nanado goes to a chief in his palace, a chief is the number one gentleman, unfortunately. Yeah, even before the head of state, he went to Ashanti in his palace. Ashanti is the number one gentleman in that palace.
Wow.
You understand? Yeah. So we should have also then organized like that. We are in the process of doing that. But it's job to be done, and I agree with you.
Now, how robust is this radical revolution we need? Because now I just came from the Middle East.
Yeah.
There's a man called Sheikh Ibn Rashi.
Yeah.
This man can throw $50 million at us,
yeah,
to develop the North.
Yeah.
With no strings attached.
Absolutely.
So would you push the envelope further?
Yes.
By calling for foreign trips?
Yes.
You know, chaperoned or escorted trips, maybe with you and Diana,
yeah,
because of the exposure,
oh, yes,
you have.
Yes, yes.
Will that be adverse? Will we be adverse to it?
No, we will not be adverse to it at all. And again, look at the resources that the Dr. Force over the years have used. Really, what catapulted Dr. Force were the battles with the British. So in the appeasement process, and because the British stayed on for a long time as colonial powers, in the appeasement process, they kind of gave some recognition to them, right? Now, we had battles with the Germans when they came trying to colonize the Transvolta northern regions. They left after the First World War, or Second World War. Yeah, the Germans were in there with us and we fought with them. If they had stayed on as colonizing powers, they would have known that the overlord of these people that we have colonized is the Ghana. And to rule them, you don't need German soldiers to follow them around. No. What we needed was to give that chicken his rightful place, and you will administer. So that's how he's thinking. So to the extent that we can use resources, and especially for the bomb, it's sometimes it's strange that the woman is not a Muslim. You understand? Yeah, the woman's trouble. What somebody says that the woman is not a Muslim. They ask them, did you go to a mission school or something? So that is to say, it's the default. So yeah, it's a default religion. So therefore, we can use almost all Muslim educated Muslims in Ghana to help us to develop that. If there's any resources in anywhere that can help, most certainly. It will not be a big revolution, because I find this kind of Ghana very, very, very receptive to us organize. I mean, so for example, this year's Damba Festival,
yes,
and I will come to you on that for help. This year's Damba Festival,
yes,
is, you know, Chief Executive of the bank,
yes,
he selected a Salana, who is a former diplomat, you know, career diplomat. So he was finished and went on as ambassador to about three destinations in Utah. He's a former diplomat. And the Chief of Nantong, who is a business person, well educated, and the Chief of DRL, okay, is elected about five of us to constitute a committee to organize this year's Damba Festival in November. That, you know, should bring together a state. You know, he wants to see the state, he wants to see all the chiefs in Ghana to come and celebrate his that bones truly united Damba. You understand? So this is an area that, yes, I would need your professional services to do that.
Yes.
Yes. And, you know, so we are very receptive.
The current year is both
receptive
and progressive.
And progressive. We are very receptive.
Now, my last question,
yeah,
and this will be the most uncomfortable you've answered in so many years.
Yeah.
Now, you've been a very conservative Muslim.
Yeah.
You've been with us, you've been with the elders, Sheikh Nyama, your good friend, MD for Japan Motors, a great Muslim, Sadiq, good morning. You've been a good Muslim and a shining example to us for decades. How do you blend the use of charms, amulets, superstition, with your Muslim faith? I know it's a difficult question.
Yeah.
It could lead to your impeachment, I don't know. Or discipline, I don't know how to call it.
No. Charms, amulets, and all of that, for me, is faith. It's faith. If you are lucky to distill your faith that you feel in the inner self, when you touch God, you have the most power. You don't need a single amulet around you. No, you don't. And everything that you need, the powers you need to be, you get. You don't need an amulet. When people have achieved a certain level of spiritual development, that internally they are constantly in touch with God, and you don't have to be bound your head on the floor to be praying. Somebody can just be sitting like he's having a conversation while he's praying. Yes, he's in touch with God. So whatever power comes from God, you will have that power around you. Yes. Now, then you have to move from there downwards. So the lesser the faith of the person, the more you want to touch something to say, God is with me. Do you understand?
Yes.
So if you will see all those guys who have it all around themselves, if you tell him to read the proper Fatiha, he cannot read the proper Fatiha. But somebody has told him that this one I've given to you is out to pursue written 120 times. So once you hold it, nothing can touch you, right? So that is his. So that is his state. That is his state. So so for me, using the amulets is only a reflection of the stage of spiritual development that you reached. Yes. If you're still very mad at the grass, you need a tree. You need something to hold. When you are confident, you don't need it. But you know what holds you out there.
It's
supernatural.
Yes.
The supernatural is God.
Wow.
So amulets and charms, no. It's just a support system.
Oh, a support
system. No, a support system to improve your faith and your confidence. Wow. That's it. It's a support system to improve your faith and confidence.
Wow.
But if you know your faith and confidence is already there, you've actually refined it clearly. You know? I mean, have you ever been in the presence of the national tribunal? How do you feel?
Yes. You feel the energy, the spiritual presence.
It's spiritual, but does it need an amulet?
No,
it doesn't. But so as you move away from that level of spirituality, you know, you may see somebody who is really there, but not yet there. He's holding two or three. And then you go all the way down. So when you go to a festival, you see those guys who move with all their tails around them. It's nothing. They just need something to hold on. For confidence, for self-belief, it's not really, it's just a state of the world. I always say, faith is like water.
Wow.
Yeah.
Analogy.
Yes, faith, the problem of faith is like, you go to the river and fetch water. When you fetch it, when you fetch the water from the river, you see leaves, right? As for the leaves, it's easy to gather them and throw them away. That's first level of purification. Yeah? In the water will be solid sand. You want to look at it, it's looking brown like this. But if you're patient and you leave the water there for a long time, all the sand will settle to the bottom and the water on top will be clearer. Okay? So you can decant the water and leave the sand. The same water. But in that water that looks clearer, I still saw some impurities which the eye cannot see. So you don't put it through a sieve. You don't put it through a sieve and filter it through. And then you still pick water. And when you look in the sieve, you see the debris caught in the sieve. Right? Then in that is still some impurities, maybe organisms. So you need to heat it and then get clean water. So our faith is like that. So by the time you're actually taking it to remove the leaves, you remove the solid sand, you're actually taking the invisible sun through the filter, and you've actually added some chemicals to kill organisms that ought not to be in drinking water, and you get it at the finest stage. That's where we're all headed to. So in our spiritual journey, we're from that pure water from the riverside,
yes,
to the very distilled end.
That's beautiful. Now, I think we will go off camera now. Next time when I visit, I would want us to discuss the impact, the long-term impact of sports betting.
I want us to discuss.
Let's
when they started, the car door was first going to be.